So, good morning everybody, welcome for this very morning session. Let me present myself for people who cannot read it because it's written quite small. So my name is Michael Scherer, I'm currently sysadmin at Red Hat for the OSAS group, and it turned out that yesterday I was there, so people from Prague will recognize some dance club, so I decided to cancel all slides because I dance too much. No, I'm not just joking. So let's say, let's start with the security auditing, since everybody likes a story where it's a story time. For me, it started with OpenShift. So does everybody know what is OpenShift? The platform as a services made from Red Hat. And it turns out this is a wonderful software, but it's written in Bash, in Ruby, and one page of PHP. And it's not for PHP bashing, well, not only for PHP bashing, because I had to do review for dependency. So for Fedora, we review package before uploading them. And we need to check that everything is working, and it turns out that with Bash, you need to read everything to make sure that there is no code in binary or something like this. And so I had to start to read the source code. And then I stumbled on this PHP page, which for PHP developers should be quite straightforward to understand, and was, well, let's say, a big security issue with the code injection. And another one with arbitrary redirect. So the security issue is that the pass info is given by the client, then directly given to the shell, so you can execute what you want. And the redirection is that, well, pass info is given by the client, and then given directly as location, so you can redirect people almost where you want. I will explain why this is bad. So I started to look around. I mean, okay, there is some PHP page, maybe there is some other stuff and everything. Turned out that there was /tmp incorrect usage. So what I did was to contact the security team, like sending, I think I spent almost all my morning on that, sending a detailed report and everything. And then I started to become more famous because it was the first time I heard my name on Linux Weekly News for something that was not some systemd trolling, which is quite nice. And yeah. So the question is why do you think you need to do code editing? Because I assume that you are interested in the topic, but maybe you do not know. So first reason is to improve your skills as coder. If you see the code of other people, well, you can see what is nice, what is not nice. You can avoid writing buggy code and then avoid giving more work at the security team. Another nice side effect, it doesn't require a long-term commitment. I used to do that in the morning commute in the train because I have 1 hour and nothing to do. After having seen Reddit for the third time during my breakfast. And this is a nice way to help free software, and I think that everybody wants to make Penguin happy. Like you can see, they are smiling, they are happy because you are helping them. So yeah, the basics. I didn't really plan due to dancing that Ayuzafa talk was just before mine. I was expecting after. So I will be quick on what is a CVE, except for the few people that were in club with me and happens to be in just now. So it's a unique identifier for a specific security problem. It's mostly used for cracking it, so everybody knows how this is called. Rather than training name like Earthbleed or whatever, it's just some number. It's assigned in some way by some people. I still do not know how. I just know that I request to a security alert and they give me one number and they do something. It's good enough for me. It's worth to note that security issue is not only code. For example, wrong permission on a file. Let's say that you have a log file and you log a password there and the file is world readable. This happened to Hugo too a few years ago. Well, this is a security issue. Sometimes it's incorrect hardening. For example, you decide to change your user and your group, and you do not change in the right order. And sometimes it's insecure default. If you have a security mechanism and it's disabled by default in the configuration, well, almost no one will use it. But not all programs deserve a CVE assignment, but all CVE assignments are a potential problem. Some are important, like everything should be stopped and you should fix it. And most are not. It's just like some stuff that could work in some very corner case by some people in some case. Sometimes that becomes more important later. You discover that something was easy and then there is another problem and then it starts to be a very, very catastrophic event. So yeah, how to spot security issue? So first by reading source code. Either the logic of the code is wrong, like it just do not do the right thing, or it's correct, but it has side effects. Most of the time this is this, because we do have, at least in free software, good developers that do, let's say, correct code. So for example of a wrong logic code, not using HTTPS for learning code, and if you think that today no one is doing this, I will say, well, is there any Java developer there? Because by default, Maven is downloading everything over HTTP. So I hope that you are not doing this from a cybercafe or this kind of stuff, because someone could just give you a wrong jar, which means code execution, because you download code to execute it. And it seems that everybody is aware of this and it's not fixed. So whatever. There is also improper check of SSL certificate, like you check if the certificate is valid and you say, no, it's not valid, but I still accept it. That's, yeah. And sometimes, yes, the logic looks okay, but there is side effect. For example, not checking return code. If you assume that everywhere it will work, it turns out that it's not the case. Sometimes these get full, sometimes they do crash and everything. Sometimes you check certificate and you still go as if they were accepted. For example, Apple, MultiLS, everything. There is the problem of not sanitizing output. I'd say you get something from a user and you just send it without checking. There is problem of making assumption about the environment. Like you say, no one will play with the server or will do anything. The world will touch to the kernel to do something, for example, for a VRM system. So for example, the previous OpenShift example was exactly that. The logic was right, but they didn't check input. They didn't check anything. This was some very old code, and it was the only PHP file in the repository, so it's quite normal. It was not an error of expertise. But yeah, our buffer overflow. If everybody that was present in the previous conference, you already know what it is. For the others, there is recording for that. There is all a cross-site scripting issue. It works when you test, but when you try to give something like some JavaScript to some HTML form, well, it got executed. Then you can execute whatever you want on other people's browser. So, to find, you do not need to read the whole source code. You need just to focus on a few heuristics. So usually you look on input, because you cannot trust the user. Anybody that did some support will already know that. You cannot trust what they say, you cannot trust what they do. Usually it's also better to look at network, because then it's really the internet at large that can access your services. And I think I do not need to explain why this is really bad. But also on the command line, if you have been in university, you know that while not all students are honest and some try to do some stuff, I could share the story of that didn't happen to me, and to some other guys that looks like me during university and what he did. I need to verify format parsing, because most of the time in an ideal world everything is specified with test, and there is real work when there is no test and no specification. So the code is the specification, and if you try to just add something, it may react differently. And you need to look for what I would call the cross-domain string, which is, for example, if you have something from PHP, paste to shell, but it also works with C to shell, or PHP to HTML, and not only C and PHP. I mean, I can complain about Python and SQL. We have some Python code that you use it to create a SQL file, or Ruby to a DLP, or anything, when there is the possibility of having something interpreted by another environment, domain, whatever. You need to look for that. You need to look for interaction with environment at large, so that means slash tmp usage. This one are my favorite because it's something very easy to spot. You just need to use a grep and you find a lot of stuff, so you can send one every week to a security team. You can check for environment variable. For example, if some program assumes that slash ls is slash bin ls, you can inject something. It doesn't work that well for security stuff and everything, but it could. And yeah, that means that a program that can be running as root will interact with the untrusted data, but it doesn't know. And yeah, last, you need to look for error paths, because that's typically something that people never check, because you know, error only happens to others. You need to verify that errors are correctly detected. Most of the time they are not, because you know it's more code and you have something better to do, like finishing your cluster of Minecraft or this kind of stuff. There is memory allocation. Again, it's too long to detail. We could make a complete talk about this. In fact, we just did. And then it's where there is the most fun. It's very specific language error. So for example, the whole story about get, post, and automated variable in PHP using some very specific configuration, which is sometimes unable. If you place something in the correct string, it will be automatically converted into a variable in PHP. So sometimes they do not take that in account. So you can basically do what you want with the code. But because Remy is here, I would not only bash PHP, there is lots of problem with the deserialization with Ruby. You can basically store a complete Ruby object in a YAML file and then send it to a process that will take it, execute it. It turned out to have been trendy last year, but I totally expect that lots of people didn't update, because some people in the Ruby community try and forget. You do some code, you push it to GitHub, and that's it. You can go back discussing on Twitter. The same goes for Wales. There is some very specific error regarding model, I think. So all of this error can be found by using automated scanner. The most known is Coverty. It's free for open source software, and I think that maybe you can have some instance running in your company, especially if this is the same as me. But if you do not have money, you can also simply use GCC and Selang. They have a lot of stuff. And in fact, once you finish to look for that, it's mostly for C code, while there is lots of tools. And not only there is lots of tools, but there is a research paper. For example, I did see one about undefined behavior in C code, because that's quite fun. If there is undefined behavior, the compiler can just decide to remove it, because since this is undefined, it cannot produce anything, so it's better to remove code. Sometimes that's code that should not be removed, like a check for the user ID, this kind of stuff. And what is also nice is that it changes with every compiler version, so something that was correct 2 years ago can be buggy after, even after you check everything. And of course, the C specification, C++ specification are just a mess, complex to read and everything, so a lot of area for that. You can do fuzzing. So personally, I did use two tools called ZUF and Fuzzy, made by two friends of mine, with, let's say, dodgy sense of humor for naming their project. Basically, the idea is that you take some random string and push it to your program, and if it's pushed, congratulations, you found some programming. Did you use that to fuse the
yes.
Then there's off instead of ZUFF.
Oh.
ZUFF.
Okay, so I will issue a patch to my slide later. See the ZUF.
There was also typo in color.
Yeah, misspelled.
Well, I hope that Google will correct you. So yeah, basically you take these tools, you just sometimes it's quite easy. If you have some, let's say, media encoder, you just give them, send the crash to the program and see if it crashes. Sometimes it's more complex. And yeah, you can find you can find remote code execution and everything. The 3D developer did found a lot of stuff in ImageMagick, and they refused to fix it. So if you have a website that processes images with ImageMagick, I would consider making sure that nothing can be exploited. And speaking of websites, there is also lots of vulnerability scanner. So something that you just give an URL and it will try to do a lot of stuff. So it should not be used on production, and especially on other people's production, and more specifically on my server, please. So yeah, using everything. So you found something suspicious? I mean, besides the fact that the code is working as intended, this is not suspicious. Well, congratulations, but maybe that's not a security issue. It's not because under some circumstances if we act worthy, it may not be a problem. So you need to qualify it, which means to try to exploit it. But sometimes it's quite easy. Let's say you have a slash TMP issue, then that makes the program crash. If you create some file, you create the file, the program crash. Quite easy. You need to find a credible scenario, which requires a lot of imagination. And IUSAFAC can attest that I have lots of imagination to find some stuff in some very specific software. Sometimes there is protection. I mean, we know that we cannot fix everything, so we try to protect everything, like SLinux, firewalls, /TMV. Usually I just, well, assume they are not here, because each time we add something, well, lots of people disable it. I do not have the feature, do not disable SLinux, but we do not today, no, not today. But yeah, that's the kind of problem you have, so you can assume that at least some people will just not have anything, so it's easier, you do not need to find a way to bypass the protection. But still you need to mention if they stop the attack. For example, you say, yeah, there is this problem, but if you use SLinux, it will be prevented or this kind of stuff. So you need to assess the importance of the problem. Sometimes it's critical and can be exploited on every possible computer, and sometimes it's not because no one is using the software and it can be only used if you are on a specific group. So if you are not sure, you need to discuss with someone. It's always good to collaborate, so if you have friends that you trust, you can discuss with them, and friends that know C code, because I have a lot of friends that I trust, but they do not know how to code, so it's quite useless. You can discuss with security contact at your job, especially if you are in an IT company. And if you have no friends and no job, you can just speak to a teddy bear. Personally, when I have no one, I speak to my co, sitting near my printer. So after discussing, if you are quite sure, or even if you are not sure, you need to get a CV. Usually you should contact upstream first, but sometimes they just do not care, so just get first a number. For Red Hat and Fedora stuff, there is a dedicated email, so you can use it if this is related to Red Hat or Fedora, which means like a package in Red Hat or Fedora. And they love receiving mail. But for other vendors, they may be some the same team, even if inside Red Hat it's quite nice, they are doing really a good job. And if there is nothing, you can just send an email to OSS sec list. If there is no typo, it will be quite easy to find on the web. Then once you have a CVE ID, or if people say, yeah, this is something that should be worthy of a CVE, I will say contact upstream privately. So privately, that means we are looking for security agencies, if there is one. Sometimes, well, there is none. Then you need to find the main developer. And sometimes, when there is none, or they try to hide quite well their email, so that's quite hard to find them. You can try to open a bug. Of course, it should be a private bug. Most systems do permit this. GitHub don't, so that's why you should not use GitHub personally. And well, if everything fails, like you cannot contact anyone, well, it's time to publicly disclose by sending an email to the proper list. Then, depending on the bug, you could have some follow-up. So the follow-up, if the bug is serious, like remote code execution and everything, there will be an embargo for a few days, so no one will talk about this. You know that it will be published in 2 weeks, but for that you should not start to go to Twitter and say, yeah, I found the problem, I can hack everything I want. You should not do that. I mean, no one should speak of the bug, you should not start to publish a patch or this kind of stuff. The coordination happens on a private list. If you are a Linux distribution, you likely have already someone. Unless if you are from the OpenBSD project, because they do not believe in coordination, it seems, and they complain when people coordinate without telling them.
LibreSSL.
Yeah. With the LibreSSL. It used to be, I think, 2 months ago. Okay. So sometimes vendor react. So some are quite excellent, I would say, well at people, and not only because they are here. They do proper tracking, there is someone that look at the bug and answer fast, and answer with correct answer, which is not something that always happens. They credit you when this is needed, if you wish or if you don't. Sometimes you do not want to have your name associated with some capacity to read the Java or this kind of stuff. So. And some are, let's say, less excellent. They deny there is a bug. They do not give you credit for signaling. They do not care, do not ask for CVO. They do not detail issue in the commit log. One vendor that did everything of this, and I want to complain publicly, is Ansible, because each time it was quite hard. There is some that denied existence of the bug, even with the clear exploit, so it was the case for Zimbra. It took 2 months to acknowledge the bug, so 1 month to be triaged, another month to get an answer for a coder to say to me this is not a problem because some other file. And I started to explain and they didn't count. So after 4 months, I decided it was time to responsibly disclose the cross-site scripting on the public mailing list. And it turned out that after 1 day, it was fixed. And yeah, there is some that do not answer. I do not want to do distro bashing, but yeah, there is a Linux Mint. I found a CVE, an error security problem in 2012, and well, the bug is still open since today. It's trivial to update, it's trivial to fix, it's trivial to exploit. I just look up and I had an answer that say, is this bug still valid? We think it's not. Yes, it is. And it's explained in the whole bug, you can test. So yeah, still not updated, which is for me a problem. But yeah, I already contributed to a distro, I will not contribute to another one. And so I think that finished my presentation. Does people have any questions, like where did I buy the co or was the club or something maybe related to the presentation?
Yes?
Just to the defense of Zimbra, they have now new owner and they seem to behave a little bit more sanely.
They do behave more sanely, I think it was mostly that people are busy and they do not have maybe the time to look at it. And it was a minor security
issue. You should look at security.
Well, it's not the time, it's the structure, right? It's a systemic problem, not we're busy.
Yeah. It's mostly I was pissed off because they told me that this is not a problem and they were looking at the wrong part of the code. I mean, I can show you the exchange and yeah. I can understand if people do not understand PHP because, again, I don't want to PHP bash, but it was the only single PHP file in the world source code of Zimbra. So, yeah, maybe they didn't know it quite well. But I explained, I spent like 2 hours on making a big mail, which would be like War and Peace from Tolstoy, even everything. So, yeah. But still, they don't swear and they fix quite fast, so for me it's okay. No other question? Because you have 20 minutes, I expected lots of people to find me on Twitter or just ask me about my life or everything. No?
Just one thing I would like to add is, even if you feel that a particular flaw may not affect Red Hat or Fedora component, it may still make sense to report it to SecSecular because we have a lot of embedded code around, right? We have a lot of code which is embedded.
Hmm.
You know, just because something may not be shipped with Red Hat or Fedora, probably you know we embed parts of that. We have had instances in which you know part of PNG decoding or you know some LC4 or something like that was embedded into a lot of these components which both Red Hat and Fedora ships.
Yeah,
so you know, if you feel it affects other distros, it affects an open source project, then you know. Probably asking on the IRC, you know, just a two-minute response, it could make sense.
So asking on IRC is working if you are working for Red Hat, but as far as
yeah,
I know,
so you could mail SecSecular and we could tell those folks that you know it does not affect us. So please ask on our SecSec or whatever.
So can I say to the green?
Yeah.
It's recorded. Can I say
yeah.
We should send you everything?
Things, not everything basically. Things, for example, you know, we may not package Zimbra or something like that, you know.
But
no.
We use it, yeah.
We use it, yeah. So that is not secular, then
true.
That is
yeah.
InfoSec, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, if something affects other distros, like, you know, Ubuntu or Gentoo or something like that, and you think it's not shipped in Fedora or Red Hat, then it may still make sense in letting us, you know, take a brief look at it. That is what I would basically say. But if it affects some kind of a PHP gallery software which shows your images, then you know it makes more sense to go on OSSEC and ask for a CVID.
Yeah, and I think that Kurt sent me that I can also ask for a CVID privately to him. Because sometimes it's not for SecAlert, but he still does the job. So
yeah.
And of course, you can also ask to other distro. Because Debian can do that, Oracle can do that, Ubuntu can do that, and everything.
Yeah.
So yeah. No other questions?
So, when you write code and you get to the end, what do you do? What does it take for you to feel secure or comfortable that your code is safe, that you don't have a lot of security vulnerabilities? What process would you recommend that people follow?
We recommend to watch the presentation of Agile Zephyr. Mostly it's first making sure that someone else checks the code, because what I see is that it was mostly code written by people that are either not experienced in security flow or not experienced in the specific languages. The example of Zimbra and PHP or OpenShift and PHP is because they didn't have an intensive experience with PHP and side effect. So I would recommend first to make sure that you know the kind of security problem you have for your specific languages. For C, it's looking for memory allocation. For shell, it's looking for shell interpolation and everything. I would recommend to use security scanner when you can as part of the test, especially with each time you find a security problem with a fuzzer, you will have a non-predictable test case. You need to test it each time, and yeah, I would just recommend to publish it, and maybe someone will get bored and look it. That's why we are using free software. We want to publish soon, publish early, and publish often. So,
I just want to add to it. A lot of upstreams have a process in which you cannot commit code till at least two people do a plus one on it.
Yeah.
So in my opinion, if you write code, you are not the best person to review it.
Yes, clearly you are not the best person.
Yeah.
I'm involved with WebKit
upstream and Google Chrome a little bit as well, and they have a process in which you know unless there is a component owner, right? They divide code base into, because Google Chrome is huge code base, right? They divide code bases into components. There's a component owner. So when you write a patch or when you write a some new code for that particular component, somebody in that component group needs to do a plus one, and then a component owner needs to do a plus one, and then they can commit the code.
Yeah.
So probably this is a good practice.
But that only works on a project that's already got enough visibility that they have that many people looking at it.
Yeah.
So that's the hardest problem. Yeah.
So OpenSSL had this issue in which, you know, since I mentioned, very few people actually understand the crypto code. So, and they had an issue in which, you know, code was being committed into upstream without actually people looking at it. So if you see Heartbleed was probably committed in 2004, 2006. And there were very few people who actually understood the RFC at that time. And it went into it. And I think now they have changed the process in which, you know, you need to review it. Now they have, I think, 1.5 full-time folks.
Yeah.
So they actually, you know, somebody actually looks at your code before you send a patch to it. So which has probably improved a lot since, you know, they used to do it last time.
But at the same time, Heartbleed wasn't in crypto code. It was a network protocol.
So if network protocol does not get a review,
yeah,
it probably crypto code may probably never get a review.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Does it answer the question? Because I stop listening. But yeah, it only works if you have a big project, because
exactly
what I see is people start a big project, then they start to use other people's
code,
and you get dependency, and then you get
some. The flip side of the coin is, isn't it the fact that we only care about security flaws in big projects? Like, you know, if there's a flaw in the kernel, if there's a flaw in the web browser, if there's a flaw in crypto library, or Xorg or something like that, that's going to turn more heads as compared with a flaw in gedit or something like that. Maybe.
Yeah.
Right. Maybe.
Yeah, well, I would expect too, right, if you had something that runs as root, right, something
yeah
that's set, those would be the things that you would want to look at really,
yeah,
really carefully. So hopefully people would be more sensitive for that kind of thing as well.
Yeah.
Well, depends a bit. From a server perspective, yes. But one of the major, if we say what's the most important stuff, it's the user's data. And the user data is the only thing that is basically completely unprotected from the user itself.
From the user.
Yeah, but yeah, that's the main issue. That's one of the main entry vector to actually capture the browser or something, or mail or whatever, and get to the data and like their passwords and their
mm-hmm
credit card and whatever they store there. So
mm-hmm
the server has a very refined model of protecting things, while on the desktop there's basically nothing. Like,
but
there's one account and we have everything in there and everything runs with the same user. If anything goes wrong, you'll get everything.
I'm agreeing with you before I say this, but to some extent every security problem is a proxy for user data loss. Right? All of
yeah
them are. Eventually the goal is get something the user finds important, and usually that's credit cards, right?
Yeah.
money. So I mean, the how vulnerable are you thing is eventually, how do you get user data out of this, or how do you use this to build a system that helps you get user data somewhere else,
yeah,
right? That's all there is.
Yeah, I just want to stress that there's a second vector which,
yeah,
from a server perspective, may be not that obvious.
Well, sometimes it's not about user data, it's just resources for our spam, Python mining.
Yeah,
and
to get user data somewhere else.
Yeah.
You're building infrastructure.
So another question? Okay, so thanks for listening.
Oh,